Dmitry Kozarev, painter. My painting's more of a biographical, listening, say, my distant relatives, people who went through the many, many, you know, terrible things that happened in Soviet Union, and then making it, in some ways, my autobiographical. Even though I didn't experience those events, they kind of mine as well. So that's where majority of my drive comes from for starting a painting. I probably would say I dated my first serious painting. It was a very traditional landscape when I was 17, maybe, 1984. I had a then girlfriend who's an artist, and I kind of followed her on plein air trips, so we would take canvases and paint outside. That would be my first recognition that I could be an artist. But not until I went to school here, start making serious decisions towards the career. Because I grew up in, say, neoclassical, maybe Baroque style of architecture. And when I came to States, it's a relatively young country, right? So a lot of architecture is clearly modernist and clearly derived from Bauhaus ideas. And Bauhaus connected to constructivism and or suprematism in a very, very big and deep levels. Another thing, I've always been simply amazed by good landscape painting. Just traditional 18th century, 19th century, even impressionists are fantastic people to look at. And it's not necessarily because of the genre of landscape or the landscape as an idea, it's more about just how loose they were with the paint on canvas. And that was really one of the things I, you know, decided to bring into my icy world. I had a great teacher at OU, Ohio University, Guy Goodwin. He's a great abstract expressionist, at least of that school, from New York, and he actually pushed me. He started figuring out what I'm interested in terms of within the art historical context, and he found this, you know, my obsession with the constructivism and so on, and he said, make a serious research about these people. And that starts sinking into my work. When I was an undergraduate, I actually decided very consciously to train myself as a figurative artist. And I spent months and months studying anatomy, working in the classes with models, just doing lots of studies. First in drawing, and then transferred everything into, start pushing it into painting, which is hard because good traditional, even academical painting. Of the figure is not an easy thing to do, so, and that was my goal. But then I abandoned it because I decided that I'm using figures only for technical purposes at the time, and I stopped using them, actually when I went to graduate school, and switched to landscape, especially because of California landscape. Probably piece behind me, actually. With this one, I only had the image that I was really interested in. It's one of the archived images from archives of the images of the unknown soldiers of the Soviet Union. And actually, there's one thing I have to tell you, that most of my figures are very anonymous. When I find the photograph, there's no credits who those people are. And usually, I like to find the images that don't show the face. So they shot from the back and makes them even more anonymous, because, you know, probably this is a bottle shot and the next 20 seconds they're all gone. So that kind of a strange waste of life, over romanticized in a ways, maybe makes me interested in. But anyways, this painting was this shot of four soldiers behind a cannon, firing the cannon. And I was also looking at the time in some Byzantine icons that in Russian culture, yes, we have, you know, we can't escape them if, you know, whether you're religious or not. Icons in the houses are always, at least in my childhood, was always there. There were a couple icons in the house. So I was a bit fascinated about that circular form that represents the nymph, right? And I decided to use those two elements together, which are very unusable. I mean, it's really almost like we're not supposed to be together, right? Here's a military photo, here's the references from the spiritual icon. So I put it together and decided, you know, go for it. Making the soldiers maybe, I don't know, saint. So I'm always giving them a little bit of a credit. It's, again, it's just the very little things that go in my mind. I mean, I don't want to make them bigger than they are, but that's what keeps going in this painting.
My name is Tomokazu Matsuyama. Some people better know me as Matsu. My dominant medium would be painting, but I also work with sculpture and installation, so I can kind of work around with the entire space to inform what I'm about. I didn't go to art school. My bachelor was actually management, and I used to be a professional snowboarder. When you're snowboarding, there's really nothing much to do at night, and I started to do a little like sketching, doodling, markers, this and that. But I got seriously injured where I had to quit snowboarding. I couldn't walk for a year. And I think that was when I was around 21 or 22. I wanted to find an outlet where I can just keep on challenging entire life. And that was art. When I came to New York, which was around 12 years ago, which I wanted to kind of devote myself as an artist. And obviously it was painting because it was easiest access, paper and pen or canvas and acrylics. So. Being a painter, I kind of hate the aesthetic of having squares in the white cube. I mean, I do appreciate it, but I would like to kind of express myself almost as if the space itself is one artwork. So the reason why I started to work with a curved canvas is trying to kind of get away from defining where the work ends and starts. I want, you know, getting into the gallery or museum or anywhere, from the entering to getting out becomes one experience and really not loosen up, you know, where the work ends and start. So that kind of has been my interest. That was why I started to work with sculpture. Because being a painter, I think a lot of painters do always have to face with the limits of what painting can do. It's pretty much line, you know, the depth dimensions. It's, after all, just pigment on linen. So it's interesting more to explore something different. And when you do, when you get back to the painting, I think it enhances a little bit and it makes us stronger works as well. So I've been working on that direction for probably the last several years, which I feel happy. And yeah. I don't want to call myself a Japanese artist. I just happen to be a Japanese artist in this international art world that I'm in right now. And I want to kind of use the best strengths out of it. And also I've been influenced heavily by the post-war contemporary art. So I am interested in really trying to pick every little element. It's probably due because I was brought up in mainly both in Japan and US. But within the two countries, I was born in a very conservative, traditional old part of Japan, but also I lived in Tokyo, where it's completely metropolitan urban center of Japan, even culturally as well. And then even in US, I was brought up in a few years when I was very little in Orange County. And then now I've been in Brooklyn and New York for 11 years. Initially, I was brought up in a very classical old city of Japan, and I came to OC, and it was a whole entire surfing, skateboarding culture in the 80s. And then I went back and they treated me as completely American. And it was hard for me to adapt back. But now I'm still in New York and people see me as Japanese. So initially I had this identity crisis within my life where it was a kind of an important issue for me to keep asking myself who I was. And when I first started painting, it was interesting because some of my friends, Japanese friends, see my work and they say it looks extremely pop art. But then when I show American friends, they reference that parts that are Japanese. So I figure when people see a painting, they see something more foreign rather than what's domestic about it. So I thought that was interesting because it started to relate to myself. Like I never thought art would really portray my identity crisis that I had. So that was when I started to consider, well, what would happen if I were to intentionally bring the aspect of Japanese, aspect of all the skateboarding culture or the pop art that I was influenced by, as well as the graphic, as I mentioned, and just really kind of blend in everything all in one. So it's not just, you can see portions of it, but it's really blended in and hybrid and resonating each other. So a lot of people ask whether my painting is portraying my personal history. It is in a way, because I'm referencing my past, but it's really, at the same time, I want to keep distant. So that's why I want to blend in those diversity in one piece and still make a statement where everybody can feel comfortable and feel uncomfortable. So. LA for me is a very big location place for me, because I was brought up in very classical, traditional, conservative part of Japan, and then I came to Orange County when I was 8 or 9. So the biggest influence was coming from that aspect of Japan to here. So for this show, I wanted to make this work that has to be significant to LA. So I made this little sculpture, which is titled LA Has Got a Lot to Say, which is, I've recasted a porcelain that was made in 18th century from China, which is erotic porcelain. And I recast it with acrylic and repainted exactly the same. But on top of that, I made a Cholo Los Angeles LA tattooing on top of it. It's referencing both aspects of myself. And also you see that kind of cultural mix here. So I wanted to portray that and kind of make it funny, humorous statement. The largest curved piece, which the title My Dog Can't Walk, is another strong piece which was very specific for the show, which I feel very strong about.